know how many of you are aware of which is your generation. How many traditionalists do we have? Meaning born between 1900, 1945. Raise your hand. All right, we have some. Baby boomers, how many are here? All right, okay, I have a lot more of this. How about Gen X? Whoops, okay. Millennials, where is you? All right, we have the millennials. And anyone after 1997? Raise your hand, all right. Sophie, when were you born? 2000, all right, so okay. So one of the things is we tend sometimes to say this generation behaves in this way, and we need to remember, I mean, there are exceptions and not every generation, actually everyone behaves in that way, but there are certain trends that we find in there. But one of the things is it's common that whenever we're talking about the millennials, I confess that we roll our eyes sometimes about like, what are they doing now? But there are certain things that I also like about the millennials a lot. And one of the things that they have said is that millennials are actually, for them, it's very important to find purpose in what they are doing. So one of the things is like, why are we doing this? Give us a purpose and they will follow that. I actually read in a story about millennials is that they say something that kind of concerned me a little bit. They said, we want to have strong families. It's one of their priorities. Be strong in family and in what is a family network. And then, but in a very low percentage, we want to be in an organized religion. For them, that's not priority. And what concerns me is it shows for me that and religion has not become a place of purpose for them, as well as a place where they can strengthen their families. And I'm not blaming them. I actually sense it's a side effect of something that perhaps within church, we have not been careful and intentional. This is why I feel that this is important for our congregation. In this season of Northern Hills, we want to be honestly building this congregation to be a church that actually has an impact in the society. It's important for me to know that who we are is not something that we just keep in this place, but that we are intentionally in growing and sharing with others about the love of Christ. During this time of Northern Hills, we are trying to find what are we in this community and who we are, how are we serving, especially with changes of leadership and people that are working here. We're trying to answer how is it that God is calling us to follow our mission. And many of you probably know our mission well. Reach others for Jesus, teach and learn the ways of Jesus, and love the world for which Jesus died. That's our mission. That's why we are here. And we want to empower that. We have felt very clearly that the Lord is calling us to enlarge, to grow, to be able to claim and reclaim those places where God is calling us to say, you know, Lord, now that I am able to be here working, or this is my family, or this is my school, we claim and reclaim these places in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we enlarge the different locations where God is calling us to serve. Amen. So wherever you go, you claim or reclaim. Why is this important? Because we are called to go to those places and be the light of the Lord. We are just showing who is the Lord Jesus Christ so people can look at the Lord Jesus. But we don't do any good if you just stay here. We are called to be out there and connect with others. Sometimes it's very challenging and difficult, but we are capable because of the faith that we have in Christ. We learn that if we have one word in mind, we can do it. And that's the word, amen. That means standing firm, believe in what the Lord Jesus Christ is doing. So when you are in that amen, in that place of belief in what is the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ, then we can become that light of the Lord Jesus. Especially with our church, the way we are developing that mission is calling us to do these four very specific, tangible things. And the first one is serving through radical hospitality. Second, loving who? Everyone, as God's crafted creation. But we don't stop there. What do we do? Number three, challenging ourselves to grow in our relationship with Christ and understanding our identity in Him. And the last one, becoming what? A disciple maker. Be contagious and proclaim His hope in this world. So this is our call. Now, when we talk about that first part, radical hospitality. We are familiar with that term, and also as Brian was saying, it's something that we are hearing a lot. But we need to remember, how is it that radical hospitality is in the scripture? How is God talking to all of us about that? Is radical hospitality to serve a nice cup of coffee and that's it? That's an amazing thing to do, guys. I can tell you that. But that is not what we're talking about, radical hospitality. It's a little bit more than that. I like what this author says about radical hospitality. He says, it is a direct response to what God is doing, and therefore much more radical than normal hospitality or polite tea parties that a concept of hospitality may evoke. It's a lot more than that. Let me tell you what it is. I absolutely love this definition, especially that first part. Hospitality is a dedication to be committed to the flourishing of other people. You think how great is that? You are investing in people. You are investing in their growth, in their life, so that that person can grow better. This is why we do the third grade Bibles. We are investing in these children so they can learn the Word of God. This is why we have in this church, do you know how many worship services do we have in a week in this church? Do you have an idea? Guess. We have 10. 10 different worship services in this church. Isn't that crazy? Yes, it is. Very crazy. And Sundays at 1, when we are in La Roca, at that point, I want to say, guys, Jesus loves you. If you don't get it, you're wrong. Because we are so tired of so many services. But on the other hand, we're excited. Why do we do this? Because we are committed to help other people to learn the Word of God. 10 services. Do you want in the morning? 6:30, right, on Tuesday. Do you want at night? You will have them on WOW. Do you want them in the middle of the day? Do you want it in English? Do you want it in holy language, in Spanish? You find it in here, guys. So we are investing. So hospitality is a dedication to be committed to the flourishing of other people, which brings delight and joy and meets needs of the guest and brings glory to the host. In that sense, you can really see that it's on every page of the Bible. So we are investing so other people can flourish in their lives. I love the way we can see this in this translation in 1 Thessalonians. Let's read it together. Be the one who nurtures and builds. Be the one who has an understanding and forgiving heart. Be the one who looks for the best in people. Leave people better than you found them. Think about it. I wish this will be everywhere where I go, in my house, in my office, wherever I go, so I remember where we are. And you know, guys, this is what we are called to do. But let's just have a moment of honesty here. And while we have a great desire to do that, what happened as soon as you merged to 1604 at 7:35 a.m.? All of that becomes a theory. And you are like, what is happening? Why this guy who has this big truck needs to be thinking that he's driving a smart car? You know? And you're like, okay, compadre, go. And then with you, all my holiness is going. You know, because you just feel that tension in there. But how are we capable to do this? Guys, to be honest, if we try it in our own, it's not going to be far. I confess that I have tried and it doesn't work. Have you been there? Right. It is about learning that we are empowered in a special way. The scripture says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but who? Christ lives in me. So that's the beginning. The beginning is when we allow that powerful transformation of love of Christ come to our lives and empty us from all of those different things that are distracting us from our identity in Christ. He comes, he cleans, he restores, he empowers, and then we can become that person renewed by the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. And through that, then we can be able to go and say, you know, I want to be a person that is committed to help others to flourish in the Lord Jesus Christ. Because then the second part of this scripture says, and the life which I now live in the flesh, how do I live it? I live it by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. When we live in that reality, then we are capable to give from that reality, from the Lord Jesus Christ. So you and I are capable to do that as a fruit of that relationship with Christ. It will not be possible if you are not coming from that perspective. So radical hospitality, that is also an important concept always for Paul in the scripture. Now let me ask this question, because I was a little bit concerned when I asked it in the other service. How many letters did Paul write? Let's see if you get better. Nope. I'm going to start again. I'm going like Michael Jackson. And I'm going to say, okay, Nate, we need to start singing again and teaching the Bible. No, that's the whole New Testament. It's a good, but it's the whole New Testament. 12. Okay, guys, I'm going to start preaching again. 12. Okay. So from the 12 letters that Paul did, because we don't know who wrote Hebrews, and I believe it's Barnabas, but that's another point of the story. But one of the things we read in here is that the very first one that he wrote was for the Thessalonians. And actually, Paul loved this congregation. He actually was so happy with them. It seems that he stayed with them for like a month or more because he really loved them, almost like a parent with a child. And he was teaching them about the Lord Jesus Christ. But he needed to leave because of persecution. They were literally trying to kill him, and he needed to leave. So he left, and then he didn't hear more about them, and he was concerned. And it was that time on this world where he couldn't just say, let's just zoom them and see how they are doing, or let me check on my Facebook and see if they are happy. So what he did is he sent Timothy and said, check how they are doing. And Timothy came back and he says, they are doing great. They are also in persecution. Things have not stopped for them on that sense, but they are growing in their faith. There are some other attacks they are receiving. One of them is some group of false prophets who are coming and saying, Jesus already came and you stay, wahaha, kind of thing. And it's confusing them. And the other, there are other ones who are saying, well, if Jesus is coming soon, don't work, don't clean, do nothing, just party. And that was kind of what they were doing, literal. And like, well, if I don't need to pay, I just create debt. If I don't need to take care of me, I'm just going to do whatever I want. So Paul wrote them back and say, I'm glad that you're strong in your faith. But by the way, Jesus has not come yet. And also, in the waiting process, we are called to do one thing, and that is to be holy. And by being holy, you make an impact in the community that is surrounding you. And you are called to do that, to make an impact by being holy. So here we find Paul writing this letter and giving specific advice of how do you do that impact. Now we need to remember that Paul is, if he was from the United States, he will be from the South. You remember that? Because every time that he writes a letter, he's not talking about you, one person, but y'all. Right? So he's like, in Spanish will be ustedes or el bonche. That's another expression. I'm just creating that one. El grupo, el bonche de ustedes. All of you guys, don't teach that. If you have Spanish class in high school, don't say, my pastor told me bonche was a word. Because then we need to talk. So, okay, so it's y'all. Remember, so whenever he's telling us, he's like, for all of you guys, I'm saying this. And he's giving us this specific way of doing an impact. He says, but since we belong to the day, let us be sober. Here we go again. He's like, guys, this is not about party nonstop. When Jesus comes, that is not what we're called to do here. What we need to do is focus on how we are prepared to do that impact. And he says, putting on faith and love as a breastplate and the hope of salvation as a helmet. There are three key words that always Paul is using that we find them in here. What are those three? Faith, love, and hope. Faith, hope, and love. And he is doing this also in something that we have seen before with him in Ephesians. But here we find him in Thessalonians, but he's focusing in two parts of that. In the breastplate and in the helmet. And makes a lot of sense. If you see, he's trying to say, it's something where we need God to help us control our emotions and our thoughts in the way we interact with people. It's very special that he's putting faith in your heart as well as love in your heart. But also, he's allowing you to see how you find hope. Because you see, sometimes the world and the ways things are going around are not going to come from a place where you're going to feel hopeful. You need to find that hope in God, and then you're going to communicate that. A few days ago, I saw something that really broke my heart. I was walking with Pedro to one of the gas stations. We were buying a Diet Coke and so. And in our process of going there, I saw two guys, I think from the high school. They were coming inside of that gas station. And one of them, probably he's not even 17 years old, he was wearing this shirt that made me cry. And it was a shirt with a symbol of no. And in the middle, it was a cross. And under it says, no religion. When I saw that, I wasn't angry at him. I was sad for him. I wanted to know who were their parents or the adults around him. And I wanted almost to tell this guy and say, you know what you're doing with that? Or whoever told you that that was right is not true. Religion is not something. Religion is one thing, but don't give up on Jesus. Don't give up in that opportunity of finding hope. It's like somebody somewhere is giving up on hope on this child. And if you look at him, you probably will say, according to the world, that's a hopeless situation. But the helmet that the Lord Jesus tells us, the way he wants us to control our thoughts, is as people that we have hope in Christ. And it doesn't matter how hopeless you look for God, in Christ we always find his hope. And it is in that where we ground ourselves. But also we ground our feelings and our emotions in there. Because let me confess something. Unless I'm a weirdo, and I am, we all somehow, we have a group of people that get in our nerves. Right? We all have one. And maybe the people that get in your nerves is not the one that gets in my nerves. Some of you have tolerance for some people that is hard for me. Or vice versa, isn't it? If we confess that, now we can say, no, I'm not racist. I'm not that kind. No, maybe you're not racist against these people, but you have a hard time with these other people for different reasons. Money, social, economic level, way of thinking, they are more liberal, they are more conservative, they are Democrat, they are Republican, they are independent, they are Mexicans, they are immigrants. We can find them. And we all have some group of people that is difficult for us to accept. And you can have every reason of saying, let me tell you why. And maybe in your brain you made it to make sense. But what God is telling us here is very different. What he's telling us is that it's not about if it makes sense. That's what I'm putting in you, that helmet of the hope. Knowing that even if you say, God, but you see, that person is hopeless because he's creepy. Do you get it? God is creepy. And God is telling you, even if for your brain makes you think it is true, he's telling you, but I'm putting hope in your head. So even that person that you consider creepy, in God's hands, has hope. And why is God protecting your heart with faith and love? Because he knows that sometimes there are people around you that are not easy to feel that you love them and that you want to walk with them in life. Isn't that true? And sometimes it's even people that are in the church. And sometimes it's people that is around your family. And you say, they are really nice, but sometimes I'm not quite feeling that I want to love them. And God knows that. So that's why he's saying you need to protect with a breastplate of faith and love given by God so that even those who sometimes are not the most lovable people, you're going to be able to love. Make sense? It is hard, guys. But as we read before, we cannot expect a non-Christian to be able to do this. We cannot. They will have tolerance, but they won't have real love. They will have respect probably, but they will really not have hope for the person. As Christians, we are the only ones equipped by the love of Christ, the transformation that Christ has done to us, that then we can give as a fruit this behavior and connection with the people around us. So if you say, it's hard for me, I get it, for me too. There are some people that it's hard for me to accept, I confess to you. And God and I had these conversations before. And I go and I say, God, do you really like them? Look at them. And then God comes and says, Lupina, if you stop loving them, you stop ministry. So, suck it up and keep going in nice ways. But that's kind of what he tells me. You know, but like, just keep going, Lupina. And I'm like, okay, God, but you can't tell me you like them. And he's like, well, that's not your business. You know, and so we have these great conversations, all in Spanish. Pero, señor, ¿cómo te caen bien? Míralos, ¿cómo están estos piojos? And he looks at me and he says, pero ámalos. So we are in that conversation. But you see, there is that point when you say, I have no idea how, but I was able to love this person. I have no idea how, but as I was able to forgive this person. And that is part of that fruit. But it's that trio, faith, hope, and love. Man, if I had the opportunity to do a tattoo, that would be my tattoo. Faith, hope, and love, because I need to remember. Faith, hope, and love. And it's important to see how in the scripture it's talking about it. It's saying, we remember before God and our Father, your work produced by faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. That's how they function. The first one there is actually faith. Why do we have faith? What's faith? Faith is not about just believing. Faith is about remembering that you are part of a covenant. This is why we have faith. We remember that our God, from the very beginning of the creation, of all the creation that he had, as well as us as human beings, there has been one thing that he has been faithful, and that is that he is a God who has been in covenant with us. He has never broke his covenant. We have. But God in his faithfulness maintains a covenant. So when we talk about faith, we're not talking about a blind faith. We're talking about we are in connection with a God who has been faithful to his covenant of love to all of us. The scripture says in Thessalonians, they tell how you turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God. That was the testimony of the Thessalonians. And that's the testimony we're called to do. It's about all saying, you know, I am not going to serve anything that is distracting me from my covenant with the Lord Jesus Christ. Remembering that if he promised it, he's faithful to fulfill that. Have you seen that? That every promise God has given to you and to me, he has been faithful to that. That's why we have faith. It's an answer of that. Then the second thing is what? Hope. What is hope? I love the way this guy defines hope. God is a trained engineer. Our final stop is salvation, restoration, healing, wholeness, through the benefit of our conductor, the Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't that an easy image? I work in a kindergarten, and that helped me a lot. You know, having that image. The scripture says, and to wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus who rescues us from the coming wrath. So what hope means is that we are telling people that the story that we have in this world is not the end. Few days ago, I went with Pedro to one of the gas stations and we were buying something to drink. And while we were there, I saw two teenagers coming probably from the high school. And one of them was wearing a shirt that made me almost cry. And this guy came inside and he had a shirt with a symbol of no. But inside of the no, it was a cross. And it says no religion. And when I saw that guy, I thought, I don't think you are even 19 years old. Who has told you that that's true? I mean, that's what came in my mind when I saw him. And I grieve about it. And I have been praying every day for him because I wanted him to know, you know, I have no idea who has told you about religion. I don't even know what you believe is religion or what do you believe is Jesus. But I want you to know one thing. I know Jesus. And what he has told me is that what we have in this life is just one aspect of who we are as people. There is a life eternal that we have in Christ. We have hope. And I was concerned thinking, what happened when this kid needs to face things that are difficult? Who's gonna tell him that that situation that he's facing has a limitation? But the God who loves him is unlimited in loving him. And my heart broke. And that's why I'm glad that Josh and Pedro are in school, because I know God can use them as light in that place. And knowing and telling others, you know, we're not perfect. The moms know that. But we know that it's Christ walking with them in this time. And we know that they can rely on the Lord Jesus Christ. So why not as radical hospitality? We just share the love of Christ to the youth who's needing it now and remind them that there is a life in Christ. But then there is one other aspect, and that is what? Love. Love, I love the way that this person translates that, is hard work for others generated by love for them. The way why we have Paul talking about love, very special in this letter, is because of the love he had for the Thessalonians. And he even says, I love you as a parent. And for you who are parents, you realize that that's a very deep love. If not, let me show you one big example about that love.
Narinig ang unang iyak mo. Pero ang saya ko nung una kang umiti. Di ko man narinig ang unang salita mo. Alam kong feeling safe ka sa hapros ko. Kaya lumalaki kang tama. Di ko man kayang magsalita. Nasasabi ko pa rin mahal kita. Sa paraang tayo lang ang nakakaalam.
She did everything she could to show her love. She did everything she could with what she was empowered to do. And you see, that is the way that the Lord Jesus Christ is loving us. He gave his life for you and for me. And we are receivers of that love. Therefore, we can be givers of that love and being in radical hospitality with this world. And you know something? God is giving us those opportunities in many ways. Just a few days ago, I met with one of the members of this church. And she told me that her school, where her son goes, Bradley, they have these fields of faith. I don't know how many of you are familiar with that. But through that, they are able to go to the middle schools and just share about the Lord Jesus Christ to those students. And she talked to the principal with this crazy, wild, radical hospitality idea. And she went and told them, you know, I would like to open my house for different youth from the school and allow them to be able to learn more who is Jesus. Do you agree? And the principal from the school accept that. And let her put all these announcements in the school. And she's going to receive them for the first time next week in her house. Just think about that. Having all these middle schoolers. Have you seen how it smells when they are together? Just think about that. But she's opening the door, radical hospitality, to be able to bring Christ to all of them. So what is God calling us to do? What is the Lord calling you to do? He's calling us to receive His amazing love, that one that transformed you and brought hope to us. He's calling us to be able to embrace the power that we have through Him and go in radical hospitality. And as we read here, we are called to be able to go and love those who nobody wants to love. Be the one who nurtures and builds. Be the one who has an understanding and forgiving heart. Be the one who looks for the best in people and leave people better than you found them. Because the Lord Jesus Christ is putting you in a place better than where He found you. Amen. So I invite you today, while we are listening to this song, to take a very deep step of faith. And it is to say, God, allow me to give that radical hospitality. And be sure that God will provide the opportunities. And it's going to be hard, but it's going to be possible. But if we all agree on that, just imagine the transformation that will happen in this community. Are you willing to take that challenge? If so, let's stand up and together let's worship our God.